students, welcome to today's class. This is Sushmita Nath welcoming you to Science with Sushmita. Today we will discuss some new concepts of science. Come, let us start.
Before we start today's topic, I suggest you all should note down and learn this reactivity series. Children, you can see there is a clue given on the left side to make it easy for you to remember this reactivity series.
Chemical properties of metals. When we talk about chemical properties, we can identify the properties on reacting these metals with some other substances, elements or compounds. So when we discuss the chemical properties of metals, we will see how metals react with oxygen, with water, with acids or with other metal salts. So let us start with reaction of metals with oxygen. Now, what happens when a metal reacts with oxygen? Now, as we know, oxygen is readily available in the environment. There are certain metals which are highly reactive, and when exposed to open air, they directly react with oxygen and form oxides. So, what we can say is, very easy to remember, you just remember like this, metal plus oxygen give metal oxide. Just, you simply remember like this, metal plus oxygen give metal oxide. Say for example, sodium reacts with oxygen to give sodium oxide. Okay, you can balance the reaction like this. So this is balanced, okay? Or magnesium reacts with oxygen to form magnesium oxide and so on. Now, one more point you have to remember. When a metal oxide is formed, these oxides are always basic in nature. The oxides of metal are basic in nature. So you have to remember two points. Number one, reaction of metal with oxygen, they form metal oxide. And number two, the oxides are basic in nature. Now, there are a few exceptions. There are a few metal oxides which can react with both acids and bases to form salt and water. Such metal oxides are called amphoteric oxides. Amphoteric oxides, those which react with both acid or as well as bases. For example, the oxide of aluminium, oxide of zinc, these are amphoteric in nature. Now, let us talk about the rate of reaction of metal with oxygen. Metals react with oxygen, but depending upon their reactivity or depending upon their position in the reactivity series, different metals react or show different rate of reaction. For example, if we talk about sodium and potassium, they are highly reactive. They are topmost on the reactivity series. So when they are left in open air, directly they catch fire. That is why, if you can recall, you have studied in junior classes that sodium and potassium are stored in kerosene. They are not left in open because they cannot be allowed to come in contact with oxygen. Then there are some more metals, say calcium, it also readily reacts with oxygen, but the rate of reaction is lesser than that of sodium and potassium. If we talk about magnesium, then you have studied about the burning of magnesium ribbon. So there also you have seen we can easily burn. So magnesium undergoes combustion or burns and forms magnesium oxide. One more thing, if you remember, you may recall that in your junior classes, when you started burning magnesium ribbon, first you have to scratch the ribbon. You have to clean it. Now, what is the reason behind cleaning it? Actually, what happens if you start burning or you try to burn a magnesium ribbon without cleaning, you will see it doesn't burn. Now, what is the reason? If a magnesium ribbon, a strip of magnesium is kept in open, then what happens? It comes in contact with oxygen and you will see it forms a dull layer on it. Magnesium being a metal is lustrous, is shiny, but this magnesium ribbon becomes dull in color. Why? Because it reacts with oxygen present in atmosphere and it forms magnesium oxide, and magnesium oxide does not burn. So it doesn't burn. So we have to scratch it. When we scratch it, with say a sandpaper or a stone, then you can see its shiny surface is exposed, that is magnesium is exposed, oxide is removed, and so we can easily burn it. Another very common example of oxide formation of metal from our surrounding is that of aluminium. We use aluminium utensils at home because it's a good conductor of heat. But you will see, say for example, the pressure cooker that we use, when we bring it from market, it's very shiny, highly lustrous. But after using it for some months, you see the outer surface becomes dull. Now, why it becomes dull? Actually, what happens, aluminium reacts with atmospheric oxygen and it forms aluminium oxide, forms a layer of aluminium oxide outside it. And this is dull in color. But this is a very helpful process. And this process of formation of aluminium oxide by reaction of aluminium with atmospheric oxygen is called anodizing. Now, how it helps? It is because of this anodizing process that the inner aluminium layer gets protected. Means it is not further exposed to oxygen and it doesn't undergo further corrosion. So anodizing is a natural process by which aluminium gets protected from further corrosion. If we go further down the reactivity series, we find gold and silver, which do not react with oxygen at all. Even at high temperature, they do not react with oxygen. So metals react with oxygen to form oxide, but this reaction depends upon the reactivity of the metals. Now, let us see reaction of metal with water. So, this reaction is similar to the reaction with oxygen. Whenever any metal reacts with water, then it forms metal oxide and hydrogen gas. Metal oxide and hydrogen gas. Okay? But if this metal oxide is soluble in water, then the reaction further happens like this. Metal oxide and water, it will form metal hydroxide, which are alkalis. So, if metal reacts with water, it forms metal oxide along with hydrogen gas, and those metal oxides which are soluble in water, they will dissolve in this water, forming metal hydroxides, that is alkalis. Here we need to remember that all metals do not react with water. Now, reactivity with water also varies, the rate of reaction varies with the reactivity of the metal. Say for example, sodium and potassium, they are highly reactive. They show very vigorous reaction with water. Even if we take a pinch of, or just a small dot of sodium and we put it in water, the reaction is highly exothermic and so much heat is produced that immediately in the test tube it catches fire. So, reaction of metals like sodium and potassium with water is highly exothermic. It forms sodium hydroxide and alkali along with the formation of a large amount of heat, and the heat is sufficient enough to catch fire during the reaction. And that is why sodium and potassium are not kept in water, but they are stored in kerosene. After potassium and sodium, if we talk about calcium, calcium also reacts with water, but this reaction is not as vigorous as the reaction of sodium and potassium with water. This is less vigorous, and this also produces calcium hydroxide along with the production of hydrogen gas. Now, here what happens, a very interesting fact is that this hydrogen gas, it sticks to the surface of calcium. It attaches itself to the surface of calcium, and hydrogen being light, calcium also starts floating on the surface. So, when calcium reacts with water forming calcium hydroxide, it starts floating because of sticking of hydrogen gas to the surface of calcium. This is shown by magnesium also. Now magnesium is down calcium in the reactivity series, so it doesn't react with cold water. So it can react with water at room temperature, and it also forms magnesium hydroxide and hydrogen gas, and this hydrogen gas also sticks to the surface of magnesium and magnesium starts floating. So this is a very common question which is often asked in exam, that why calcium starts floating when it reacts with water, or same with magnesium. If we go still down the reactivity series, we find aluminium, iron, zinc. These are less reactive as compared to the metals we discussed just now. So they neither react with cold water nor with hot water. They react with water in steam form. That means when water is converted to steam, then aluminium, iron or zinc, they react. And on reacting with steam, they form their oxide and hydrogen gas. Aluminium metal, when reacts with water, then it forms aluminium oxide and hydrogen gas. Now, since this aluminium oxide is insoluble in water, the reaction will not carry on further. Same with, say, iron, ferrous, when it reacts with water, which form? This will be in steam form, not normal water. What, cold water, hot water, it will not react. Only with steam, it will form iron oxide and hydrogen gas. I've not balanced the reaction, children. You can practice balancing. So you will balance the reactions. So remember, whenever a metal reacts with water, it forms metal oxide and hydrogen gas. And if the metal oxide is soluble in water, then it will further form metal hydroxides, which are basic in nature. They're also called alkalis. All metals do not react with water. So if we talk about silver and gold, which are down the reactivity series, they will not react with water even at high temperature, even in steam form, they will show no reaction with water. Reaction of metals with acids. Metals react with acid to produce metal salt and hydrogen gas. So what you have to remember is metal plus dilute acid gives the salt of that metal, whichever metal we are taking, that metal salt plus hydrogen gas. Let us take one example. Say for example, sodium metal. Sodium reacts with dilute hydrochloric acid. So what will happen? The sodium will react with this and this will be released. So we get NaCl, sodium chloride and hydrogen gas. Or else we can take, say, another example, say, we take magnesium reacting with dilute sulfuric acid. So what we get is magnesium sulfate and hydrogen gas. When we talk about reaction of metal with acids, one thing we have to remember, that dilute nitric acid does not produce hydrogen gas when reacted with a metal. Now, what is the reason? The reason is nitric acid is a strong oxidizing agent. So what happens during a reaction of metal with dilute nitric acid, the hydrogen gas that is produced is further oxidized to form water. And nitrogen itself, what it does, it forms its oxide, nitrous oxide, NO2, NO3, N2O, etc. So, when we talk about reaction of metal with acid, we are talking about reaction with dilute sulfuric acid or hydrochloric acid with nitric acid. This reaction rarely happens. Why? Because this will react forming water, and this will form either this NO3 or NO2 or N2O. So this doesn't happen. But there are some exceptions. With magnesium or manganese, dilute nitric acid can easily react forming salt and hydrogen gas. Only in this case you need to remember that nitric acid can react. Otherwise, for other metals, hydrogen gas is not produced when it is reacted with dilute nitric acid. Now let us see the reaction of a metal with other metal salts. So this is also a simple revision of what you have studied in your junior classes. Now say for example, we take a solution of copper sulfate, and you know this copper sulfate solution, it is blue in color. And in this, what you do is, so this is copper sulfate is a salt of a metal that is copper. Now in this blue colored solution, if we put some iron nails in it, okay, some iron nails in it, and you leave it for some time, for several hours, after that you will observe this blue colored solution. Suppose this is blue in color, you will observe this blue colored solution will turn green in color. It will become greenish in color, the color of the solution will change. Now why the color of the solution will change? How it has changed from blue to green? That means this change of color means something new is formed, isn't it? So this is, now if it is green in color, means it is not copper sulfate now. It has become something else. What it has become? It has become ferrous sulfate. It has become the sulfate of iron. Now how it has become ferrous sulfate? It is because iron has reacted with copper sulfate, and iron being more reactive will displace copper from its salt solution, and copper will be released out. Okay, so we get FeSO4, and this is green in color. So which type of reaction is this? If you can recall, this is nothing but a simple displacement reaction. So when a metal reacts with another metal salt, then more reactive metal displaces the less reactive metal from its salt solution. But we should keep in mind that this type of a reaction happens only if the metal that we are adding is more reactive. Now if this is a less reactive metal, say for example, had there been a silver or gold, see if we add silver here, then will there be any reaction? No, there will be no reaction, because silver cannot displace copper, as copper is more reactive than silver. So this will not happen and the solution remains as such.
Now you can try to solve these questions based on the concepts discussed in this video.
So students, I hope you have understood the topics that I have covered in this video. Until I come up with my next video, keep learning, enjoy learning. Thank you.